St. Ambrose Church in Berkeley, and Sunday, April 13th at 4 p.m. at St. Augustine's in Oakland. For more information, call 510-604-5732 or log on to berkeleybroadwaysingers.org.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for Terra Verde.
From the Amazon basin, from the magnificent redwoods of California to the icy majesty of the Arctic, life on Earth faces an unprecedented threat from careless development. Join Terra Verde over lunch today to find out about the unfolding future of the planet.
Hi, I'm Adam Greenfield, and you're tuned in to KPFA or KPFB in Berkeley or KFCF in Fresno. This is Terra Verde, an environmental radio show. You might remember my last show on Terra Verde was the 28th of February, and we were talking about reusable bags on that occasion. And I swear, since that show, I have not been able to touch a plastic bag since. And I can't even bear to look at people using them in my store. So if you haven't heard that show, go to our website, kpfa.org, and listen to that show, and hopefully you'll be converted just like I was. Anyway, today... Okay, so did any hijinks you pulled on April Fool's Day compare to this? Locking yourself to a bulldozer near the construction site of Duke Energy's cliffside coal-fired power plant in Charlotte, North Carolina? Or did you blockade the main entrance at Citibank's Upper East Side headquarters in New York City and chain yourself to the front doors with police having to saw you out? Or did you lock yourself to the front entrance of the Bank of America branch in Copley Square in Boston? Well, unfortunately, I certainly didn't. But over 100 such actions happened around the world that day on April the 1st. And they weren't so much inspired by April Fool's Day, but by Fossil Fool's Day, a day of action against the fossil fuel industry. And now we know who the biggest fossil fools are, thanks to the Foolies. Now, what are the Foolies? The Foolies are the Fossil Fools Awards of 2008, presented by the Energy Action Coalition, Co-op America, and the Rainforest Action Network. Now, I have managed to round up in the studio Rebecca Tarbottom, Global Finance Campaign Director of the Rainforest Action Network, and also Brianna Keokota, Communications Director at the Energy Action Coalition. And I brought them here to Terra Verde to tell us more about the Foolies. Okay, Brianna, first of all, let's talk to you. So I talked about some of the things that happened on April the 1st. What else happened?
Oh my gosh, Adam, it was such an incredible, inspiring day of action all over the world. Over 100 actions, young people standing up in opposition to dirty energy as usual and promoting clean and just energy solutions. Definitely what you mentioned, amazing actions at coal plants and coal exploration sites all over the U.S. and also in the United Kingdom. There was also... A solar installation that happened on a native reservation up in North Dakota. There were the opening of a bike repair shop in Montreal to make biking as a sustainable transportation alternative easier for people. And we had great fun at the big oil hearing on Capitol Hill on Tuesday when the CEOs of, or the executives from the top five oil companies had to have their day of reckoning on the Hill. And we had billionaires for oil dressed up outside, really challenging them not only on rising gas prices, but also on rising sea levels. And it was a Mod Podge. And if you go to fossilfools08.org, you can see report backs from all over the country, all over Canada. Great photos, videos being posted to really get a feel of the day.
And there are also people chaining themselves to diggers in Wales over in the UK. I mean, it was worldwide, wasn't it?
It really was worldwide.
It was crazy. Well, that's absolutely amazing. We're going to get more into that later. But first, Becky, okay, so Fossil Fools Day attracted a lot of attention. You guys obviously did something right in organizing this. What makes for an effective campaign for galvanizing action? How did you do this?
Well, Adam, I think the very first thing that makes an effective campaign like this is great partners. So I think the first thing that we all did right was join together. So RAND, Energy Action Coalition, Co-op America, and really create a really firm foundation of groups that have wide and diverse networks. I think the other thing that strikes me is that, you know, I don't know if you saw the New York Times poll this morning that came out that said that 81% of Americans are dissatisfied with the way this country is going. I think the key to successful campaigning right now is partly because these campaigns tap into a really deeply held dissatisfaction with the direction of our country, of the global economy, and particularly when it comes to climate. So people are just ready. They're ripe for some kind of action.
And this was definitely a very effective stunt that really attracted people's attention. But the Rainforest Action Network, or RAN, is definitely known for that kind of thing, isn't it? I mean, what else have you guys done in recent years?
Well, I think that, you know, one of the things that we're doing really successfully right now is actually working on a coal campaign, which is trying to get the big banks to stop financing coal and start financing a green future, which is part of what the fossil fuels actions were all about. We've done some other really fun stunts, like hang banners. We've done things like get the billionaires for coal out at bank branches all around the country. And I think what's good about this work is that it's both really asking for cutting-edge reforms at corporations while also directing people and corporations towards solutions. So although, you know, what we see in the media, what we see gets the most splash is a lot of these funnier, creative, really exciting actions, but a lot of that is underpinned by really tremendously broad and wide grassroots organizing and education at the very base level.
Okay, right. Well, let's get into the substance of the show. I can't wait any longer, neither can you. Let's talk about the Foolies 2008. Now, Brianna, you're going to take us through some of the winners of the categories. Just tell us briefly, what were the Foolies about?
Okay, so the Foolies were the first annual Fossil Fuel Awards to go around with the Fossil Fuels Day of Action, which has happened for the last 4 years.
This year was the first year,
but I can tell you
so
we will
exciting.
Be people. We're already starting to get nominees for next year. So watch out, you fossil fools. You will be exposed. So basically, what we did is Rainforest Action Network, Co-op America, the Canadian Youth Climate Coalition, and an Energy Action Coalition went out to our membership base. You know, tens of thousands of young people care passionately about these issues, are working in their communities and on their campuses to stop dirty energy, and who know these fossil fuels better than anyone. And we asked for nominees, and we got a flood of nominees in. You know, we thought we were only going to do the Fossil Fuel of the Year, but when we saw how many very deserving nominees there were, we decided to set up some other categories. So there was Most Inauspicious Newcomer, Best Greenwashing, a couple other categories. And in total, we had over 6,000 people vote in the Foolies, and also really like probably about 15 people around the country, 15 groups around the country did actual live deliveries of awards to many of the nominees. And
okay.
So, you know, we saw it go offline and into communities too, which was really exciting.
Excellent. Okay, now we're going to go through the Foolies right now. So this is our own award show here on KPFA Terra Verde. And at the end of the show, I'm going to open it up to our listeners out there. Do you have a Foolie that didn't make the list that you really think deserves to be on there? Well, if so, give us a call. The number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. We'll squeeze you in at the end of the show towards the end, and our guests here will opine or provide their opinion on the nomination. So let's start with the Most Inauspicious Newcomer. Who won that and why?
Okay. Archer Daniels Midland CEO Patricia Wartz won the award for Most Inauspicious Newcomer, given to the individual who has burst into the public consciousness in the past year as a major contributor to global climate change. Now, you know, many people have had lots of problems with ADM for a number of reasons for many years, but this year we're seeing a massive outpouring of understanding about ADM and other major agribusinesses companies responsible for pushing palm and soy oil expansion in pristine rainforest to develop biofuels and other things that are absolutely devastating local communities, the environment, and really compromising any chance we have at solving this global climate change problem. For example, ADM has a controlling share in a Singapore-based agribusiness called Wilmar. And Wilmar is the world's largest processor of palm oil and palm-based biodiesel. And they started clearing pristine rainforests in Indonesia, which are some of the last remaining habitat for the endangered orangutan. And they have just been clear-cutting it and releasing so much greenhouse gas emissions, CO2, into the atmosphere when they're cutting down these peatlands. And we've seen when they started their expansion in Indonesia in 2005, Indonesia has jumped from being the 26th world's largest greenhouse gas emitter to number 3. And so that ADM, Patricia Wartz, absolutely very deserving of this title for her role and her company's role in really pushing this sort of rainforest exploration and greenhouse gas emissions.
Okay, Patricia Ward, CEO of Archer Daniels Midland, or ADM. You're out there somewhere. You're driving to work or going to work. You're doing your thing, and we know you're out there. Thanks,
yeah, we're
to the
on
Foolies.
To you.
Excellent. Okay, well, let's go on to the next one then, which is outstanding performance in corporate greenwashing. Now, greenwashing, of course, is growing at an exponential rate because everyone's talking about the environment now. So who got this one? I'm really interested to hear this one.
Yeah, this was a personal favorite of mine. This is GM General Motors CEO Rick Wagner, and he was given the outstanding performance in corporate greenwashing as the person representing the company that has most aggressively tried to fool the public into believing it is working to benefit the environment. And there are any number of ways that GM and Wagner could be responsible for greenwashing. Basically, it comes down to the fact that they are doing mass advertising, online advertising sort of things, pushing this image of green cars when we are not seeing those cars on the roads today. So instead of, you know, false advertising to people, we want them to start mass producing the vastly more fuel efficient, less greenhouse gas emitting cars that we know that they can be producing. The technology exists today to create cars that get at least 100 miles per gallon. It is time for GM to stop talking about going green and start actually putting those cars at affordable prices in the hands of every and onto the roads in America.
It's amazing, isn't it? We have Hummers that do 8 miles to the gallon, and we have cars, you know, on the drawing boards in someone's office that can do 100 miles to the gallon. I mean, it's incredible.
Absolutely. And GM is the company that's pushing the Hummers, too.
And one thing I just add to that is that, you know, while GM is pushing this green image and all this green propaganda, at the same time, they're engaged in a legislative battle to try and undermine legislation in California and 11 other states that would actually legislate reduced vehicle emission standards. So, I mean, it's one of those things where they're not, what they're actually doing behind the scenes does not match up to the rhetoric they're speaking in public.
Greenwashing through and through, isn't it, really?
Indeed. Really, it really is. Textbook case.
Okay, well, let's hope someone writes that textbook soon. Okay, category number 3. This is a very interesting one. The Lifetime Achievement Award. I wonder if people will be surprised as to who win this.
It's probably the smallest surprise of the entire contest, are that George Bush and Dick Cheney dominated the Lifetime Achievement category. And that was due to their persistent, career-long efforts to actively block progress on any sort of efforts on climate change, as well as, you know, absolutely being in the pockets of big oil and King Coal, and we see that in every policy that they've come forth with. Mm-hmm. The listeners of KPFA understand, but they, I mean, these leaders really are pushing billions and billions of dollars in government subsidies into the hands of oil and coal companies, who many of them who they worked for before, and at the expense of investing our nation's resources in efficiencies and clean and renewable energies that we so desperately need right now. I mean, let alone the fact that they've, you know, gone over the advice of their own government scientists and have denied the existence of global warming and stymied any progress both on a domestic and an international effort, international level, to deal seriously with the problem.
Mm. I mean, now that in more recent times, they had made some move to saying, okay, there might be an issue, we're going to look into it. But that almost seems like that's their way of getting into the climate change talks in order to slow them down.
I mean, they can talk all they want while chunks of Antarctica the size of Manhattan are falling into the sea. And we need the billions of dollars that this government is currently giving to oil and gas oil and coal subsidies and other dirty energy going immediately into building up the clean energy infrastructure that we so desperately need.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, those guys are on their way out.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Hey, we're partisan. Okay, right. Well, now we're going to go into the fossil fuel of the year. And Brianna, you're going to take us through the four runners up. And then, Becky, you're going to take us to the winner because you're an expert on the winner. So this is going to be interesting. Who came in at fifth biggest fossil fuel of 2008?
That was Dynegy Corporation CEO Bruce Williamson, who was nominated because of the company's unceasing promotion of dirty coal power. They are one of the coal companies that is most strongly pushing coal expansion at exactly the point in our country's history when we need to be having an immediate moratorium on it. And, so they're a winner for many reasons, but they came down a little lower. But they are set to see a national campaign started against that has already begun against Dynegy. So I would bet that come the Foolies next year, Dynegy is going to score a bit higher.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Number four.
ExxonMobil CEO Rex Tillerson. Again, not really a surprise that he's on the list. We did deliver a Foolie award to his VP that was at the big oil hearing on Tuesday. I mean, the crimes against ExxonMobil are kind of limitless. They are the world's largest oil company. They're doing everything that they can to promote oil and, you know, drive oil resource wars, and they are... they're definitely a major fossil fuel.
Rex Tillerson. Learn that name, listeners. Learn that name. Rex Tillerson, CEO of ExxonMobil. Coming in at number three, this is a surprising one, or maybe not, but it's not a name that I know.
This was the GM CEO, Rick Wagner.
Oh, yes.
it was a close race down at the end.
I actually got number three. I think I got them the wrong way around. I had Al Stelmach.
Oh, let's talk about him. He actually came in second, a very close second to the top winner.
Well, let's get Rick first of all, because number two is interesting.
Okay, so Rick Wagner, we've already talked a bit about him and GM, but just to bring it home, to keeping America addicted to oil by mass producing gas guzzling Hummers that average 8 to 10 miles per gallon and actively blocking state efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from vehicles. And then there is the Alberta Premier Ed Stelmach, who is maybe somebody not a lot of people that are listening right now have heard of, but he is absolutely a driver behind one of the most environmentally and socially destructive projects currently being undertaken in the world. He is the premier of Alberta, which has the tar sands. And every day, 1 million barrels of oil are taken out of the tar sands. And 70% of that oil is shipped down and exported into the U.S. for our consumption. The tar sands represent the second largest oil reserve in the world, but getting the oil out of the ground comes at an incredible cost. If fully developed, the tar sands would destroy an area the size of Florida. There are incredible health problems with the indigenous communities surrounding the area that are experiencing very rare forms of cancer at very alarming rates. And as well, the project will single-handedly break Canada's commitments under Kyoto.
And you showed me some pictures before the show. It looked absolutely horrific. We're going to have to move on now to the top fossil fuel of 2008. Now, Becky, you're going to announce this one. Who is the biggest fool of the year?
Well, Adam, the top fossil fuel of the year award goes to Ken Lewis, CEO of Bank of America.
Oh, dear.
Yes. And as I think many of the listeners probably already know, Bank of America is coming under tremendous fire at the moment for its intense investments in the coal industry. Right at a moment when, you know, the mass of public opinion is shifting towards realizing that we have to get this country off fossil fuels, that far from building out our coal infrastructure, we need to be putting all that money into financing renewable energy and energy efficiency in a massive, massive way. Bank of America is is one of the gatekeepers at that crux, at that pathway division that we're at. And Ken Lewis, although he is speaking a very pretty talk about green commitments, you might have heard that Bank of America, actually, ironically, on April 1st, also won an award for their green building in New York City, which, fantastic, great that they did a LEED certified building. We're concerned about what's going on inside that office building. What's happening? What are the bankers doing at Bank of America? And by all accounts, from all of our research, they're putting all of Americans' money into financing a build-out of coal infrastructure.
This is our money.
This is our money. I mean, Bank of America is the largest bank in North America. It has an enormous amount of Americans' personal money through checking accounts, savings accounts. They hold our mortgages. And that money is being invested in exactly the kinds of projects that Americans are saying they don't want. We don't want more coal. We don't want more fossil fuel infrastructure. We want alternatives. We want to move into a low and no carbon future. And that's not what Bank of America is doing.
And this is something that a lot of people don't realize. You know, you don't just put your money into the bank and it sits there doing nothing.
Right.
People are actually taking your money without your knowledge or consent, and they're doing stuff with it.
Absolutely.
Stuff is happening. Your money is out there financing some project right now, and you don't know about it.
Absolutely. And, you know, the banks are starting to get a little wise to the fact that Americans are realizing that they have a say, or they should have a say, over what happens with their money. And that's why we're seeing all this enormous amount of propaganda about their green commitments, their green investments. While actually most banks, Bank of America included, is putting about 1% of its energy into what amounts to 1% of its carbon emissions, so looking at trying to reduce its buildings' emissions and so on, when 99% of the emissions that those banks are responsible for are from their financing, from the money that they're directly investing into fossil fuels. And not only investing in coal-fired power plants, but also in tremendously destructive extraction methods like mountaintop removal in Appalachia, where Bank of America is the top funder of companies that are engaged in mountaintop removal, which literally sweeps the top off of mountains and dumps them into the valleys, creating huge ecological impacts and also on the communities in Appalachia themselves.
Well, Ken Lewis, you are the top fossil fool of 2008, CEO of Bank of America. I'm sure many people out there bank with them. So what are we going to do about it? Well, we're going to talk about that in a second. This is Terra Verde, an environmental radio show weekly on 94.1 KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno. So today we're talking about the Foolies, the Fossil Fools Awards of 2008, presented to the biggest contributors to the fossil fuel industry. And joining us in the studio, Rebecca Tarbottom of RAN, Rainforest Action Network, and Brianna Keo-Cotta of the Energy Action Coalition. Okay, so let's talk about the Foolies. They've had a huge effect this week. How vulnerable are big corporations to this kind of action?
I think they're tremendously vulnerable. And these corporations, particularly the highly branded corporations, but all corporations in general, rely on the social contract that allows them to keep doing business. They rely on consumers on every level of their business to continue to purchase their products, to continue to bank with them, whatever it might be. And when the confidence in those corporations starts to be shaken through actions like the Foolies, through people taking direct action at their banks or at, you know, outside of Dynegy, for instance, or, you know, ExxonMobil or any of these places, those corporations really take notice. Their brands are very vulnerable, and they know that.
And it's funny, isn't it? Their biggest strength, which today is the brand, is a very big weakness. What about the choice in the Foolies of naming individuals and then the company? You know, we've got Ken Lewis, then Bank of America. Explain the thinking behind listing the person and then the company.
Well, I think that we see these days a great paucity in responsibility taking by individuals at the very top of corporations. Most of the time, we don't associate ExxonMobil with an individual. We don't associate Bank of America with an individual. But there is somebody who is at the helm of these organizations who gains tremendous benefits from the way those companies do business, and so therefore should hold a tremendous amount of responsibility for the impacts of their operations. And once you can reach these individuals, once you can actually get the message to them, there's two things that can happen. One is that they can be so embarrassed by what their company's doing that they can make a change. Or otherwise, you know, many of these people actually want to do the right thing, may not have the information, may not know exactly what some of the impacts are of their investments or their operations, and could well create changes inside the organization. It creates some political space inside a corporation often when they get outside pressure, like from the Foolies.
Okay, so the red-faced Bank of America customers out there, okay, a little bit embarrassed, but, you know, that's fine. We can do something about it. What can we do?
Well, the first thing that they can do is they can go to RAND.org and sign up for our mailing list, and they will then get regular instructions on exactly what they can do to take action on Bank of America as well as Citibank, the two top financiers of coal and climate change in America. The second thing they can do is not to feel embarrassed, because being a customer of one of these banks actually gives them tremendous amount of power. What we're seeing is that there is leveraging public opinion and consumer power allows us to really turn the tide against these corporations. And so if you're a customer of Bank of America, find out how you can take action. Go and tell your bank that you have a problem with their actions. Write them a letter. You can do that through our website, rand.org, or you can go in and talk to your bank manager individually. Right now, as a customer, you have leverage, you have power, and you should be willing to use that.
And, you know, if anyone out there doubts the power of their money, look at the power that Bank of America has wielded using our money. I mean, all these projects that they finance, that's our power. We just don't know it. It's hidden from us, but it's already, the evidence is there. It just needs to be swung the other way.
Absolutely.
Every billion of dollar that they're currently spending on this dirty energy really, really could be spent instead on investing in clean and just energy choices. And I think, you know, many of the youth in our coalition absolutely see the power of that and want these banks to start investing in our future instead of continuing to invest in dirty energy.
Now, at the beginning of the show, I made a call out for anyone nominating their own fossil fools of the year. And we have a caller on the line now who wants to nominate. We don't. Okay, we don't. Sorry. There we go. But we're gonna wrap up. But the number for the show, I don't think we have much time. But if you still want to make a late call, the number is 510-848-4425. And do you guys have any personal fossil fools that didn't make the list?
No, you know what? My dreams came true when Ken Lewis was elected fossil fool of the year, because I deeply feel that he is the fossil fool of the year. Although, you know what? Any one of these individuals, any one of these companies.
Okay.
I would have to say, for me, when I voted, I actually didn't vote for Alberta Premier Ed Stelmach. But the more that I've learned about him while working with our allies up in Canada, the more that I absolutely think that he was very deserving to win Canada's Fossil Fool of the Year and beyond. And I think that the tar sands especially is an issue that we need to seriously start thinking and working on south of the border, because it's for our, the oil is for our consumption, and we need to work on that.
Now, the show's almost over, but we do have a call from John from San Francisco. Who's your Fossil Fool of the Year, John?
It's Red Emerson of Sarah Pacific Industries. He may not be quite the world-class polluter, but he's in, you don't have to go to Indonesia to see clear cutting. They're doing massive clear cutting in the Sierra here in California, which, as your speaker mentioned, releases enormous amounts of carbon that should be holding it. It should be a sink instead of releasing it. And they're going to clear cut up to 1 million acres, and they own 1.5. So I just want to call your listeners' attention to Red Emerson.
Thank you very much, John. That's fantastic. Thanks for your contribution. Now, the show is come to an end, unfortunately. Brianna, how can we find out more about the Energy Action Coalition?
EnergyActionCoalition.org.
Okay. And Rebecca, Ran, how can we find out more?
RAN.org, RAN.org.
Oh, it's so easy. Okay.
So easy.
Thank you so much for having us on the show today,
yeah,
Adam.
Yeah, that was great, Adam.
I enjoyed it. Thank you guys for joining us. And thank you to Erica Bridgman, our engineer, who's as clean as a whistle. We hope you'll join us next week on Terra Verde. This show and others, as I said earlier, are available from www.kpfa.org. We'll see you next time.
Organic vegetables in every front and backyard. They're doing it in Cuba, and we can do it too. Come watch a film about urban gardening in Cuba, the power of community, and then let's talk about cooperating with our neighbors to do it here. Saturday, April 12th at 7 p.m., a benefit for the Berkeley Unitarian Universalists at Cedar and Bonita in Berkeley. For information, call 510-540-1975.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KF.